morning, everyone. I'm so glad to have you this morning. Delighted that you are here. Hope that you're having a wonderful summer so far. I know the last couple of days have been pretty scorching hot. The next few days apparently are supposed to be a little cooler, but nevertheless, just glad that you're able to be with us this morning. I know there's a lot of people that are coming and going as travel plans have been planned out, and vacation times and seeing family and taking trips and all of that sort of thing. But we're just really delighted that you've chosen to be here this morning and want to welcome you to this worship service together. We gather to do what that song talked about, that all God's children can join together and say, He reigns. And I hope this week that you've experienced that somewhere in your life. And then today we definitely want to be able to meditate a little bit on something about that very topic. And so I want to welcome you to this worship service. If you are visiting with us this morning, or if it's been maybe your second or third time, we just want to extend a very warm and gracious welcome to you. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. We would love to be able to connect with you better. There's a connect card, looks like this, at the welcome desk, as well as a gift there. If you have not done that, either it's your first time today or second or third or fourth time even, would you be willing to do that for us? We just want to have a record of your attendance and help you be able to connect with us as we find out how we can better serve you. So we want to welcome you and ask you if you'd help us with that. A second thing is a couple of quick announcements, items of ministry that are taking place. First of all, Colin Reed has finished our next generation student ministries pastor, has finished his ordination process that took about 4 years. And I know he's glad that that's behind him. And we're going to celebrate that coming up on Saturday, this coming Saturday, August 5th at 10:30 here at the church. If you are available and able to be here, we would welcome you and invite you to come celebrate with him as he's completed this process. There will be a meal following that, and we're just delighted to be able to join with him. Colin's not here today. He was speaking at a youth camp over the week, and we just want to invite you to be aware of that. Also, this evening, there will be a prayer meeting. We do quarterly prayer meetings here, and so we just want to invite you to come back 6:30 to 7:30, just a time for our church family to gather together to seek the Lord and ask God for his guidance and help. And I keep trying to press upon us as a church that the gospel advances on through two things, the word and prayer, nothing else. And so I hope and want to challenge us as a people that we will take prayer seriously. And so I want to invite you to come back join with us as we just seek the Lord together. The last thing is, you notice on the chairs, this card there, and I just want to point out one particular announcement. This has everything that's happening in the month of August, but on the back, there is an announcement concerning a ministry fair. And so what is a ministry fair? Well, in 2 weeks, on August 13th, following the service, will be an opportunity for you to be able to get familiar with a lot of the key ministries that take place in our church. Get information, volunteer if you want to volunteer, sign up, ask questions. And so we want to invite you again, August 13th, following the service, 2 weeks from today, in the fellowship hall. We'll be having our ministry fair. You can see a list there of all the ministries that will be being featured, and those who lead those ministries being there to help answer questions and just give out information. So you can get involved that way. We invite you to do that. Following that Sunday, so August 13th will be our ministry fair. August 20th, the next Sunday, will be when we will restart our life application group ministry. And so just want you to be aware that we are getting back into the swing of things as summer comes to a conclusion and we get back to school and so forth. So just want to make you aware of that. This morning, as I call us to worship into our the worship of our great God and Savior, we come to the question, again, if you've been with us, you know that each week we select one question out of the New City Catechism week to week. It takes us through the whole year, and we come to this particular question: are all people, just as they were lost through Adam, saved through Jesus Christ? Are all people, just as they were lost through Adam, saved through Jesus Christ? And this is one of those places in the Bible where we bump up against a particular truth, a doctrine that God reveals to us that's often challenging emotionally and challenging mentally. One thing I want to help us as we give the answer here is to recognize that there are two representatives in the Bible, or two heads of two races in the Bible. There's Adam, the representative, represented us in the garden, and Jesus represented us at Calvary. And these two heads have a people. And if you are born into this world, you are born into Adam. And when you are born into Adam, you are born separated from God. He represented us, and because of his choice to disobey the Lord and walk in his own path, all of us fell into sin. And so we are of the race of Adam. But God has worked to bring about the Lord Jesus Christ into the world that he might represent us at Calvary. And because he has done that, God has selected out of the race of Adam a people for himself, a people comprised of all nations all over the world. And he has selected a group of people out of Adam's race. And so when we consider, are all people, just as they were lost through Adam, saved through Christ? Here is the answer. And I'm going to read it, and then we're going to read it together. I'm going to make one comment. No, only those who are elected by God and united to Christ by faith. Nevertheless, God in his mercy demonstrates common grace even to those who are not elect, by restraining the effects of sin and enabling works of culture for human well-being. Now, what does this answer tell us? It tells us something very important. It tells us something absolutely critical for us to grasp, and that is that God is God. Let that sink in. God is God. And we, being God's creation, live under the authority of God. And there's two things to grasp about God. One, God is sovereign over all things in the world, including salvation. And he is working out his work after the counsel of his own will, as it says in Ephesians. God is God, and we are not. God is sovereign, and he is working out salvation after the counsel of his own will and for his own purpose. That's what Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 1. And not only is God God and God is sovereign, but God saves by grace. God saves by grace. There is nothing else. There's nothing in you. There's nothing in me by which God would be moved to save us. We were lost under Adam in sin. And so when God works out salvation, he saves by grace. And so when you come to him this morning as those plucked out of the fire, as it were, saved by his grace, you come to worship and uplift his name and acknowledge you are God and I am not. And so I want to call us this morning to the worship of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's say this together. No, only those who are elected by God and united to Christ by faith. Nevertheless, God in his mercy demonstrates common grace even to those who are not elect, by restraining the effects of sin and enabling works of culture for human well-being. And then the verse from Romans chapter 5. For if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Would you bow with me as we pray and just ask the Lord's blessing on our time together? Father, when we come to you. And we hear and see of these magnificent and great themes. The fact that you are the Lord God Almighty. That you reign supreme over all of your creation. That there is nothing that happens in this world and in this universe that you do not understand, ordain, rule over, comprehend, and manage. And that includes us. And so, God, today we come to bow ourselves before the High King of Heaven. Oh, Father, would you grant us access to you, not because of the things that we have done or would do, but because of the blood of Jesus Christ shed on the cross for our sin. We come because you save by grace. And now enable us, Lord, as we worship here together, to bow our heads, our hearts, our knees, our mental capacities, our emotions, in the presence of the Lord God Almighty, the Sovereign Lord. Even as Jeremiah said, O Sovereign Lord, would you bless us? We bow before you in silence. Just invite you for a moment, just quietly, to quiet your heart in the presence of God.
A strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. A strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. A strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not face, you won't grow weary. the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and now of Zion's hill, salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the wool, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah, 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 there's no God like Jehovah. Riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's the year of jubilee,
understanding. You would see
are still to prosper. You've not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. Faithful forever, perfect in love, you are sovereign over us. You are wisdom unimagined. Who could understand your ways? Reigning high above the heavens, reaching down and in this craze, you're the lifter of the lowly. Passionate and kind, you surround and you uphold me, and your promises are my delight. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and
reading for today is in Acts 22, verses 12 through 16. And it says, "And one Ananias, a devout man according to the law, well spoken by all the Jews who lived there, came to me and standing by me and said to me, Brother Saul, receive your sight. And at that very hour I received my sight and saw him. And he said, The God of our fathers appointed you to know his will, to see the righteous one, and to hear the voice from his mouth. For you will be his witness for him to everyone of what you have seen and heard. And now, why do you wait? Rise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, praise team, for leading us in time of worship. I hope that your heart has been warmed and you have been able to genuinely, truly be before the Lord in his majesty and his sovereignty and his goodness and his faithfulness, and in anticipation that someday he will come and the clouds will part and there will be a trumpet call of God and we will see the Lord. I hope you're looking forward to that day. I am. Behold, he will come. I want to invite you to open your Bibles to Acts chapter 22. And you might be thinking, I studied Luke chapter 11 this week in the study guide, and so Pastor Page, you got it wrong. We're supposed to be looking at the Lord's Prayer, and I don't have it wrong. I just sensed and felt in my own personal life and prayer life and trying to think about where we are as a church that the Lord would have us study a passage of Scripture and consider a specific aspect of discipleship, which happens to be following the Lord in baptism, following Jesus in baptism. At the end of this month, we are going to have a baptismal service, and it feels fitting to me, and I think the Lord has led me to bring before you and lay before you some teaching on baptism. Now, I don't know how much teaching you've received over the course of your life. I don't know what your particular view on baptism is. I don't know if you've been personally baptized. But I sense that the Lord would have us think about baptism as a particular aspect of following Jesus. He commanded that we would baptize those who become disciples in his name, and therefore we should think about why did Jesus feel it necessary? Why was it important to him to institute this thing called baptism? And I want to lay that before you this morning. Now, I have kind of two overarching goals. One is to think about what is baptism, what is its nature, what does it teach us? And then secondly, what is its significance for you as the believer? And for us as a church as a whole. And so we'll kind of have those two overarching goals in mind as we look at this particular passage, Luke has given to us an account of Paul as he was recounting his conversion experience and what Ananias said to Paul as he was ministering to Paul in those very, very early days of Paul's salvation and Paul's conversion. And so I want to lay this before you. Now, as I said, I don't know if you have personally been baptized. I'm not sure all the teaching that you've received. I don't know how many of you were baptized as infants, because we have people in our church who come from different backgrounds, but it is my aim this morning to not only try to teach us about what the Scripture teaches us concerning what baptism is, but if you have not been baptized, to convince you of the importance of this piece, this aspect of your journey with Jesus in discipleship. And so I am preaching both to those of us who have been baptized, that we might grasp its understanding and know what that was about. And I'm also preaching to those of you who have not been baptized, for whatever reason that might be, that you might be convinced of its importance. And so I want to lay this before us. Now I'm going to begin with a definition of what baptism is, and then we'll try to unpack that a little bit. Baptism is an ordinance instituted by the Lord by which those who have repented have come to express their union with Christ in his death and resurrection by being immersed in water in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Spirit. It is a sign of belonging to the new people of God and an emblem of the burial and cleansing that has taken place, signifying death to the old life of unbelief and purification for sin. Now, can you say that back to me? That's a long definition, isn't it? That's because baptism means something. Baptism is important. Baptism is rich in meaning, and therefore there isn't any simple one-liner to explain it. You have to understand its significance, and so I want to press upon you, O believer, what baptism is about, and for those who have not been baptized, why does the Lord want you to take this step? Okay, let's pray. Father, help us. Lead us. Teach us. Enable us to grasp this truth. Help us not to put it off as insignificant, but to embrace its richness. Enable our minds to grasp things we have not understood. Help our eyes to see things we have not seen. Help our hearts to respond in faith, trust, and obedience. Lead us in your truth, Lord. We're before you. Thy word is before us. Help us. We ask these things in Jesus' name, who died and gave his life for us. Amen. This passage, this one, I just want to focus on one verse from Acts 22, verse 16. And now, why do you wait? Rise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on his name. It's probably not a typical passage to preach from in terms of a baptism, but there are four things in this passage, that in this one verse, that it teaches us about baptism. First of all, baptism is an entreaty to God. It displays an entreaty to him, or an appeal to God. Baptism expresses personal faith. Baptism is an emblem. It's a picture. And then lastly, baptism is essential. It's an entreaty to God. It expresses personal faith. It's an emblem. And then lastly, it's essential. Let's look at that first one. Baptism displays an entreaty to God, or an appeal to God. Now, we're going to kind of work backwards in this verse. We'll start at the very end. Ananias says, call on his name, call on his name. Now, let me just be very clear from the outset. Baptism does not save anyone. The ceremony of baptism, the act of baptism, having been baptized at some point in your life, does not make you right with God. If I ask you, are you a Christian? And you say, well, I was baptized when I was 10. Or I happen to be baptized as an infant. My parents took me and did it. You do not understand salvation. Baptism doesn't have the power to save you. See, the verse says, calling on his name. Who has the power to save you? His name. That's who does the saving. So, why do we call on his name? Well, the verse says, Ananias says to Paul, why do you wait? Rise up, be baptized, wash away your sins, calling on his name. Now, that little phrase, wash away your sins, That's one of those phrases, like if you're a reader and you're reading through or you're just listening to me say, wash away your sins, that just sounds, yeah, right, wash away your sins. Just like that, we take it. Have you ever stopped to think about the significance of a statement like that? Wash away your sins? Do you know how hard it is to wash away your sins? Do you know how much effort you and I have put in our life trying to wash away our sins? And yet here Ananias says, rise, wash away your sins. Just like that, they can be gone. What an amazing statement. And we can read that and just blow right past that as if it's just commonplace. Any old day, that can be done. Don't you grasp and understand? Can you see, brother or sister? What a magnificent statement that is. What a gigantic statement that is to wash away your sins. You see, you and I know deep down in our hearts that there is something wrong with us. Deep down in our lives, we know that we are not right. And all our life, we have been trying to put that not right thing right. We have been trying to cleanse ourselves. It reminds me of I'm not a great reader of this, but the story of Lady Macbeth, you know, in for those of you who love that sort of thing, there are very few of you in this room that I know love Shakespeare, and I'm one of those. But, you know, that part of that Lady Macbeth where she has murdered and she's got blood on her hands and blood on her garments. And what does she say? Out, damn spot. Out, damn spot. She can't get rid of it. You see, wash away your sins is something that you and I have been trying to do for all our lives. We've been trying to get that spot out. Trying to cleanse ourselves, trying to make ourselves right. Let me give another little illustration. Every one of us every day do the same thing. When we get up to go out into the world, we take a shower and we cleanse ourselves, don't we? We want to wash the dirt off of our body. And the reason why we do that little procedure, that little ceremony every day, and you did it this morning, is because when we go into the presence of people, we want to be presentable. Right? You want to be presentable because you know that to go into the presence of another person, if you're not presentable, they're going to reject you. Now, if that's true by a simple little thing like cleansing your body on the outward, what must it be like to be in the presence of a holy God who looks not at the skin, but at the heart, and who sees all the stuff that is there? You see, the idea of washing away your sins is no little simple phrase. Wash away your sins is something that you and I have been trying to do all our lives. We've been trying to deal with the sin that's there. Oh, how do we do it? We try to cleanse ourselves in all kinds of ways, don't we? Oh, moral reform, I'm going to work harder. I messed up, but now I'm going to really do it. We try to cleanse ourselves through our efforts. We try to cleanse ourselves through doing better next time. We try to cleanse ourselves by working harder. We try to cleanse ourselves by looking at other people and comparing ourselves to them. And sometimes we find fault in someone else so that we can feel better about ourselves. And sometimes we are trying to just get someone else to approve us. Why do we do all these things? Why do we engage in all these charades and games that we do? Why do we try to get our identity out of our jobs or our careers or how much we've accomplished or who we are or who we know? Why do we do all that stuff? Trying to deal with this thing called wash away your sins. You see, Ananias said to him, Paul, rise, be baptized, and wash away your sins. Have you been able to succeed in and of yourself at dealing with that spot? See, wash away your sins is not something that can just be brushed over so quickly. Why do we call on his name? Listen carefully. All of the efforts that you and I put in to trying to make ourselves presentable before God never work. We never feel clean, do we? All of those things never really satisfy. Calling on his name is when you stop trying to clean yourself and instead you ask God to wash you. You ask God to do the cleansing. You ask God to be the one who washes your soul. And so that first idea is that baptism puts on display that an individual has stopped trying to clean themselves and instead has turned to God and made an appeal, made an entreaty, and asked God to do the washing. And baptism shows who has done it. Now, who do you call on? The context tells you in verse 14, the righteous one. Isn't it interesting that Ananias would refer to Jesus as the righteous one? See, he comes to Paul and he says, Paul, you've been chosen that you might see the righteous one and hear a voice from his mouth. And so when you call on his name, it's not just a name that is general and amorphous. It's a particular name, the righteous one. You're calling on the one. See, you're not righteous. I'm not righteous. And so baptism is the fact that I've called on the righteous one to do the cleansing. So baptism is a public display of an entreaty, an appeal that has been made to God that God might do the cleansing. Second, baptism is an expression of personal faith. See, because you are calling on his name, see that? You're calling, it's the faith that's there. You're calling on his name, and because you are looking away from yourself and have asked God to be the one who does the washing, then baptism is an expression of the faith that you have exhibited toward God. You have stopped trying to wash yourself. You've stopped trying to play the game of I can fix myself. You've stopped trusting in yourself. And in place of that, you have called on his name. It's an expression of the faith that you're exhibiting towards him, that he can do the washing. And therefore, because it's an expression of faith, it is only for believers. It's only for those who can and do call on his name. Baptism is for believers. Now, I'm going to raise an issue here. I'm not sure if your mind is already beginning to consider this or think about it, but I'm going to raise an issue here that we ought to think about, and that is, well, what about infants? Should we baptize infants? Is that a proper application of what the Bible teaches about the nature and significance of baptism? Now, I'm conscientious of the fact that our church is made up of a lot of denominational backgrounds. God in his providence, and I really don't know why, but God in his providence has seen fit to gather into this family people who have come from about every denominational background that you can think of. And I praise God for that. Some of you grew up in denominations where infant baptism was practiced and taught. Some of you might have been or likely were baptized as infants. And I want to give to you the reasons why we here at this church practice believers' baptism, and why we do not baptize infants. And I want to show you the very best I can from Scripture why would we come to that particular place, why that conclusion. Now, I'd like to say to you, if you believe in infant baptism, and if you're a paedobaptist, that's the technical word for the term, paedobaptist, paedo meaning child, if you believe in that or been taught that, I want you to know you are welcome here. We are glad that you are here. You can fellowship with us. But I hope that you will give serious and careful consideration to what to this aspect of baptism as we all seek to walk in obedience to Jesus. In order to do this, we need to look at one verse out of Colossians chapter 2. It's up on the screen. Here's what it says. In him, in Christ, also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith, in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead. Just a few things for us to notice. Let's go back a slide there, Steve, if you don't mind. Go back one more. Yes, thank you. Notice, first of all, that there is a circumcision that happens that is without hands. See, in the Old Testament, you notice right up there, in him you are also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. In the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, circumcision was done how? It was physical, and it was done with the hands. The sign that you belong to the covenant community, the covenant people of God in the Old Testament was physical circumcision. But in the New Testament, under the new covenant, in the blood of Jesus, the circumcision that is done is spiritual, see that, and done without hands. In other words, what happens when you come to faith in Jesus, what happens to you when you come to faith in Jesus is that God does a circumcision spiritually, internally, inside of you, and he cuts away the body of flesh. In other words, spiritual circumcision is when the old person, the old one of you who lived in the flesh, who lived in your strength, who lived for yourself, who lived trying to cleanse yourself, that person spiritually gets cut away. It's not a physical act, it's a spiritual act. The old man or the old woman, which was under sin and under death, and that resides in the flesh, gets cut away forever, and what is left is the new you alive by the Spirit. That's what this verse is talking about. God does something absolutely amazing on the inside of us when we come to faith. He circumcises us spiritually. That's the first thing, a circumcision that happens to us without hands. Secondly, the spiritual circumcision that happens and the image of baptism are linked together. You cannot separate spiritual circumcision from baptism. They're together. And they happen through faith. Look right there. Notice, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith. How does spiritual circumcision occur? It occurs through faith. So you have all of these amazing things that happen. Spiritual circumcision, God does something on the inside. That old person cut away. The circumcision that God is doing in Christ, buried with him in baptism. How does all of that amazing stuff that happens the moment you come to faith in Jesus occur? It comes through faith. Paul makes the exact same statement almost, very similar in Galatians 3. In Christ Jesus, all are sons of God through faith. For as many of you who are baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now, what are some implications then from this teaching? You might ask the question then, well, why wouldn't we, if baptism is the corollary to circumcision, why wouldn't we then baptize infants if infants were circumcised in the Old Testament? Let me give you a few answers. In the Old Testament, the sign or the mark that you belonged to the people of God was physical, and it was done by hands. But in the New Testament, the mark that you belong to the people of God is baptism. Baptism is the mark that God now has instituted. So you see, baptism points toward what? The internal work that God has done, that spiritual circumcision that God has done, and that comes through faith. See, internal spiritual circumcision can only happen, it cannot happen physically. It can only happen, it cannot happen outwardly. It can only happen inwardly. And therefore, baptism is given to who? Those who exercise faith. And infants can't yet exercise faith. Baptism is the sign that is given to those who exercise faith. Also, in the Old Covenant, Israelite boys and men were circumcised. But in the New Covenant, under the blood of Jesus, there's a shift that takes place. And that shift moves from Israel to all nations. And that shift moves from men, just men, to men and women. And so, the sign of God's ultimate final provision of salvation is the sign of baptism. And that signifies membership into this new covenant people of God in the blood of Jesus Christ. Lastly, membership in the new covenant is not physical birth. See, in the old covenant, membership in the covenant was signified by physical birth. How is membership signified under the new covenant? It's a spiritual birth. The new birth happens by the Spirit of God through the Word of God. And therefore, the sign of membership in the new covenant for the people of God is not a sign for infants, but rather for believers. And listen carefully to me. We baptize not physical infants, we baptize spiritual infants. That's what baptism is about. It's about how God has rescued us, and it has happened through faith. And therefore, it's for those who have exhibited faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Acts 22 tells us, be baptized, calling on his name. Third, baptism is an emblem. Notice again, thinking some more about that phrase, wash away your sins. Baptism was ordained. It's an ordinance. That's where we get that word from. To picture on the outside what God has done on the inside. It's an emblem. Baptism is a picture. It's a dramatization of what God has done. How do you know if your sins have been washed away? Is it just be baptized and that's it, all done? Now you can go on how you're living however you want? No. Baptism puts on display what God has been doing, God has done when he united you to Jesus by faith. Let's look at Romans chapter 6. One verse out of Romans 6, this is what it says. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Now, let me be very clear about this particular passage. The primary meaning of this passage is spiritual baptism. It's you being united to Jesus. That's the main point that Paul is trying to get across. But since Jesus has instituted baptism as the sign of the new covenant, then both spiritual baptism and physical outward baptism are in view in this passage. The primary meaning is spiritual baptism, but since Jesus has instituted baptism as the sign of what this is about, both are in view for us to consider. So, you unite to Jesus by faith, and because you have united to him by faith, you're baptized into Jesus. Baptism, then, is showing outwardly what has happened inwardly, or let me put it another way. When you watch a baptismal service and you watch somebody being baptized, you are seeing with your eyes what God has done inside that you cannot see. Get it? The outside experience, the picture that you're watching it, God, Jesus wanted us to be able to see physically what happens internally, spiritually. And that's why baptism is such a critical piece of your life. That's why it's so important to the church of God, because this thing that happens in our life is through faith, and through faith you're like, Lord, how do I grab hold of these things? And baptism is God's way of being able to dramatize for us what he did on the inside that you don't get to see, at least not yet. Now, what happens? Let's look up here again, next slide. What do we see? What's your testimony? We see three things. We see death, his death. We see burial, his burial. And we see he was raised from the dead. That is what? Jesus' story. Jesus died. Jesus was buried. Jesus was raised from the dead. And when you unite to him by faith, when you put your life into his life, when you say to Jesus, you wash me, you cleanse me, and you unite to him by faith, what happens to you is his story becomes your story. See, you die. You are buried. You are raised again because your life is enmeshed, united to him, just like as much as a marriage is. And so his story becomes your story. Now, let me ask you, how do you unite to Jesus? How does that happen? By vows. I'll use the illustration of marriage. When marriage happens, how does the marriage occur? It occurs through the exchanging of vows. I take you to be my wedded husband. I take you to be my wedded wife. Vows establish the marriage. And what is the sign of the marriage? The ring. The ring is not the marriage. The ring is the sign that the marriage happened, that the marriage occurred, that the marriage exists. When you unite to Jesus, what happens? You take vows. You say to him, Lord, I take you to be my Lord and Savior. Wash me, clean me. I take you. You will be my God. You will be my lover forever. That's the vow. And what is the sign that the marriage between you and God has happened? What sign is given? Baptism. Baptism is the sign that the relationship of union between you and Jesus has occurred. So, what do we have? Baptism is an entreaty to God. It's an appeal, cleanse me. It's an expression of personal faith. I respond by faith, and it's for those who do and can and have. And baptism is an emblem. It pictures what God has done for us in Christ. It puts on display so that we could see outwardly what he has done inwardly. Now let me conclude. Baptism is essential. Now I use that word essential purposefully. Baptism, I do not say baptism is necessary for salvation. There are plenty of examples in the scriptures of people, particularly the thief on the cross, who was not baptized yet was saved. But I do say that baptism is essential to discipleship. It's part of your discipleship. It's part of walking with Jesus in obedience to him. And so what things can we conclude from Ananias's question, why do you wait? What a question to ask Saul. Why are you waiting? Rise, be baptized, wash away your sins, calling on his name. Several things for us to consider this morning. Number one, baptism is not an optional piece of discipleship. It's not if you want to. It's not if it suits. It's not if it's convenient to you. It's not if it feels good to you. Baptism is something that the Lord has put in your life. Jesus ordained it. And I am certain and I am convinced that there's probably likely some in our church who have been putting this off way too long. See, it's a matter of obedience. It's the mark of your entrance into the family of God that God has done something amazing in your life. It's the moment in your life when you give glory to God for what he has done and that he has rescued you from sin and death and darkness. So it's not optional. Second, who should be baptized? Believers. Those who have come to faith in Jesus should get baptized. And they should do it once they have come to faith in him. So let me say directly, personally to you, again, I told you at the beginning, I'm making an appeal to you this morning. If you haven't been baptized, and you have come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you just have never taken care of this, I want to urge you, I want to exhort you, in the Lord, be baptized. Why do you wait? I put the same question to you Ananias put to Saul. Why do you wait? Rise and be baptized. What if you were baptized as an infant? I would simply urge you to consider the importance and meaning of what baptism signifies and what it's about, and it's that it's through faith, not faith that you might have someday, but the faith that you have exercised in him to wash you and cleanse you and unite him yourself to him. See, it's through faith. Let me be very clear. I do not say and would not say that if you were baptized as an infant that your baptism was invalid, but I would say to you it is an incomplete understanding of the nature of what baptism is about. And therefore, I would urge you to more thoroughly and faithfully grasp this teaching as the will of God and as the teaching of Scripture in order that you might follow him in what God has outlined for you. Lastly, if you were baptized at some point in your life, but you look back and you say, I know I wasn't saved then. I did it because people around me were doing it. It seemed cool. I didn't want to be left out. I would urge you to be baptized because you have, if in fact you have put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. See, it's through faith. And so I want to leave those three things with you. Finally, what are some reasons that we can have for not doing it? Some may think it's just not that serious. May I say something to you? The Lord gave his life for you. He put himself on that cross for you. He took it serious. And when he instituted baptism, go and make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. I think he was being quite serious about what he meant baptism to be about. You see, even at the beginning of the service, God is calling out a people out of Adam's race for himself, and he wants you marked that you belong to him. Therefore, you should be baptized. Secondly, some of you might feel embarrassed in front of others, in the presence of others. May I say to you, the Lord was stripped naked for you, that you might not be ashamed in the presence of God. And so, may I urge you, be baptized. Put your embarrassment aside and say, Lord, I see you were stripped naked for me that I might not be ashamed in your presence. And I'm not ashamed of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Some of you might fear giving a testimony in front of others. May I say to you, the Lord made the good testimony in front of Pilate on your behalf. Therefore, be baptized. And finally, some of you might not want others to know that you haven't taken this step. Oh, brother or sister, the Lord has identified with you. He put his name upon you that you might identify that you belong to him. And so may I urge you that you would stand up and say, it doesn't matter to me. Who knows that I haven't done this? If it's been a long time, I am identifying. I belong to Jesus. He's my Lord. And so I just conclude. And I want to urge you the significance and importance of baptism, what it's about, what God has done. In 4 weeks, we will have a baptismal service. I already have about 10 people on my desk who have indicated some interest in baptism. I hope that that number will grow, and I'm praying that it will. And I want to challenge you, if you haven't taken the step, to walk in obedience to the Lord. Maybe there's somebody here this morning, you've never trusted Christ at all. You've still been trying to cleanse yourself. You've been trying to do the work to make yourself clean. Oh, would you stop trying to cleanse yourself and turn and ask, lift your eyes to heaven and say, God, would you cleanse me? I see that Jesus died on that cross to make me clean in your sight, and I want to receive that. I hope that you will do that. And may I say finally one last thing to the church? It's kind of common for us when baptism times come around, especially since the way we do it is that we have a picnic together and then we do baptism, to consider not going because, well, it's just a picnic. Oh, if that is your attitude, may I challenge us to think it's not a picnic. It's the moment when we as the Church of Jesus Christ gather together and see the cleansing that God has done in the life of a soul that will live forever in his presence. It's not a picnic. It's a moment of holy worship to stand and see, God, you made a soul that could never cleanse itself get clean for your presence. And so I want to urge you and challenge you with all of the energy I can possibly muster that you would be there to witness and give glory to God, whether you're being baptized, and I want to challenge you to please follow the Lord in this, or if you are simply there to be because you've been baptized, but you want to join with those who are taking this important step. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we bow before you. We know and understand it took your blood, took your life. It took you shedding all of your glory from heaven to come and be one of us so that we could be washed, we could be cleansed. And you want that to be known. You want that to be seen. You want that to be celebrated. You want that to be marked in our lives. And so, Lord, I just pray and I ask that you would help us as a church to not dismiss this piece of discipleship as just a ritual, just a thing we do, optional, but rather, Lord, we would grasp hold of its significance. Oh, to be marked out by God. Might that grasp us? Might that resonate with us? Might it enable us to worship you more deeply and more fully? And Lord, I pray, if there be anybody in here this morning who has never trusted Jesus as their Savior, God, would you speak to them that they would cry out to you and say, Lord, I'm done trying to wash myself. Would you wash me? Would you clean me? And Lord, if there be people here who still have not walked in faith and in obedience in this particular aspect of discipleship, would you give them the courage and willingness to do so? We ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. Would you please stand for the singing of our final song?
Our closing worship will be He Reigns. I heard a few brave people trying to clap for Days of Elijah. Don't be scared, it's okay. If you mess up, we'll all forgive you. It'll be fine.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, she reigns. It's all God's children singing glory. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from the thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. All the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. And so I got children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he waved, he waved. All God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he waved, he waved. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he waved, he waved. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he waved.
You can clap for that. Praise God. Hope that you are encouraged this morning. I just want to conclude our service this morning as we end this morning, that as we say each week, if the Lord has spoken to you, whether you personally this morning have something that you want to pray about, or if you're carrying a burden that you're asking God to help you with, we always have our elders and a wife and their wives up front. And so we want to invite you to take advantage of that. At the conclusion of the service, there's coffee in the fellowship hall. For those that are staying for our summer class, we'll be back in here in about 20 minutes. And so we invite you to come back and join us in that. Would you receive this benediction? Now may the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and my love be with you in Christ Jesus. Amen. You're dismissed.